which is a generalization of the notion of stability data on graded Lie algebra. We introduced it with Maxim in 2008 as a mathematical structure underlying the well-crossing formulas for generalized DT invariants. But we discovered later that it's kind of ubiquitous. So we found it in the framework of complex integrable systems. And we found it in Gromov-Witten theory. And today I'm going to discuss it in a sort of a more basic class of examples, which are easier to understand. Basically, I will be explaining the structure in this class of examples. And this is examples related to exponential integrals. So I will consider the exponential integral, this I of h bar, as a function of h bar. H bar will be a non-zero complex number in my talk. And so the integral, of course, this symbol requires several explanations. In particular, we need to specify the class of integration cycles, which I'm not going to do, but you can imagine that this class should be such that the integral converges. And in terms of topology, it can be like such integration cycles can be found among integer combinations of real and dimensional oriented manifolds. So wall here is a volume form, although in general, it's not necessary that it's nowhere vanishing. It's just a top degree holomorphic form on X. All right, so the parameter h bar, as I said, it belongs to C star, and the wall crossing phenomenon, it's related to the change of the argument of this complex number. All right, so the wall crossing formulas, which I will make very explicit, and actually it's possible to make them explicit if we can choose a nice basis in the integer relative homology of X with respect to its boundary at infinity, which I can denote like F minus one of Z, where Z is a sufficiently large point on the complex plane. And so to make things precise, assume that X is scalar and F is Morse. So it's holomorphic on Morse. So it's all Morse indices are the same and equal to the dimension of X. So here on the notation, theta is the argument of H bar and S is a set of critical values, distinct critical values. So, and there are also critical points, which I denote by xi. And so for these data, I can define an integration cycle, which is called thimble. This is a notation. And it's a union of gradient line for this real valued function originated at the critical points. So they can be thought as gradient lines, or they can be thought as Hamiltonian trajectory for the imaginary part of the same function. And for that, for this Hamiltonian interpretation, we use the symplectic structure, the imaginary part of the Keller form. And for the gradient interpretation, we use a Keller metric. So in any case, thimbles, they are homeomorphic to Rn. And this is a geometric, this is a picture. So this is a thimble. And so each thimble is projected to the ray originated at the critical value. So thimble starting at xi projected to the ray in the particular direction. originated at the eye. All right. Now, with each symbol, we can associate an exponential integral of this type. It depends on the symbol. And I will assume that H bar does not belong to the Stokes ray. There are many different ways to say what is a Stokes ray, but the simplest possible probably is this one. The argument of H bar is different from arguments of difference of critical values. So, and I will assume that critical values, they are in the general position, which means that if there is a critical a Stokes ray Sij, then it contains two different critical values, not three. Three is not a generic position. And so I can kind of order these critical values by their proximity to the origin along the Stokes ray. And now the wall crossing formulas, which are kind of a basic structures underlying the stability data or wall crossing structure. It's something which is necessary in order to define whatever it is. So in this particular case, it's very simple because it's basically the sort of a Picard-Lefschetz theory. And if we have a Stokes ray containing two critical values, Zi and Zj, and let's order them, as I said, by proximity to the origin, then there is a relation between two integrals along the corresponding symbols. So Ei, when H bar crosses the Stokes ray, Sij, it changes by this number. Nij are integers, and you will see several, at least probably two or three different interpretations of these numbers. In particular, you can think of them as a number of gradient trajectories of this function which joins critical points xi and xj. So we are in the holomorphic situation, and so Morse indices of these points are the same. So there are no gradient lines generically, but for Stokes directions, they do appear, and Nij is a number of these gradient lines. So then in a sense, wall crossing formulas replace Morse differential in holomorphic setting. All right, so let's rewrite these wall crossing formulas in a slightly different way. First, let's introduce modified exponential integrals. So this factor, of course, refers to the stationary phase expansion with respect to h bar as h bar goes to zero. So I would like to get rid of this. So then the rest has a Taylor expansion in H bar with a non-zero coefficient. And the wall crossing formulas for unmodified integrals over thimbles now becomes jumps for their modified version with, you see, with this Nij, which control these jumps. All right, now the same wall crossing formulas can be encoded in a different way in terms of the Riemann-Hilbert problem. And in fact, the Riemann-Hilbert problem is essentially equivalent to the still undefined in my talk wall crossing structure. I will do it later, kind of more formal definitions, but in the case of integrals over thimbles, the wall crossing structure is encoded as a Riemann-Hilbert problem for the vector, which consists of all all modified integrals over all possible symbols. So since we knew the jumps of each coordinate of this vector when we cross the Stokes ray, so we know the jump of the vector. And also because of this exponential factor, because of this exponential factor, essentially the asymptotic expansion of jumps has a trivial, if you like, it has trivial Taylor expansion along the Stokes ray because this is exponentially small. So anyway, this Riemann-Hilbert problem, so now I defined it rigorously, it's for this vector or sequence of CK valued functions, these are these functions. They are defined at the complement of C star to the union of Stokes rays because the integrals were defined under this condition. And these are jumps along a given Stokes ray Sij, which contains two critical values, Zi and Zj. So Psij doesn't change, and Psi changes by this factor with this exponentially small term as h goes to zero along the Stokes ray. Now, as any Riemann-Hilbert problem, it can be thought of as a trivialization outside, at least outside of Stokes rays, of a holomorphic vector bundle on C star with a coordinate h bar. All right, so, and now a little bit more general story. So the notion of, so what we saw, these formulas, they underlie a certain structure, wall crossing structure, and moreover, they underlie the notion of analytic wall crossing structure, which is a subject of our last year paper with Maxim. I will tell you later what does this mean. First, to be a wall crossing structure, and second, to be an analytic wall crossing structure. This is what I will do in the next probably three slides. But whatever analytic wall crossing structure is, it always give an analytic holomorphic fiber bundle, not a vector bundle, but in general fiber bundle over C star. So the role of this black box analytic wall crossing structure is that they lead to resurgent series in the parameter, in this H bar, sections of those analytic vector analytic fiber bundles, they have asymptotic expansion as H bar goes to zero, and this is a resurgent series. Now, since you have this non-commutative geometry in the title, so I can kind of say that from the point of view of infinity categories, which are non-commutative spaces, if you'd like. In this particular case, we are talking about an infinity category on the Foucault category of T star of X, considered as a real manifold, real symplectic manifold. The resurgence is encoded in the upper bounds of the virtual numbers of pseudo-holomorphic disks with the boundaries on two Lagrangian submanifolds. And the geometry which is related to exponential integrals, it's a geometry of two Lagrangian, complex Lagrangian submanifolds in T star of X. One is a zero section And the other one is a graph of the differential df. And we can incorporate h bar either by rescaling f or by rescaling this standard symplectic structure on t star of x. So these pseudo holomorphic disks are absent generically, but they appear when h bar belongs to Stokes ray. And it's, of course, the same story as appearance of gradient lines between two critical points of f, which I mentioned previously. All right, now we come to a rigorous definition of the simplest example, or rather basic example, where it started with, of wall crossing structure. It's a stability data on a graded Lie algebra. It's certain abstract structure, which, as I told you, it underlies a lot of interesting examples, both in, actually not just both, in algebra, geometry, and physics. All right, so I will follow our original definition in this paper, 2008. So first, I start with a free abelian group of finite rank. In physics, it appears as a charge lattice. Now, I will consider in this part of the story, the gamma-graded Lie algebra, say over rationals, or you can consider over any field of characteristic zero, whatever you'd like, but if it's over rationals, then of course that's okay. And so then the stability data on this graded Lie algebra, it's just the two pieces of data in one axiom. So first data is a homomorphism of the lattice of this charge lattice to complex numbers, homomorphism of abelian groups. It's called in physics central charge, and mathematicians accepted this term. For example, in the Bridgeland definition of stability structures on triangulated categories. So there is a homomorphism called a central charge. But the main thing is a collection of elements, A of gamma, which belong to the graded components of this Lie algebra, provided gamma is non-zero. This A of gamma, in particular, informally should be thought of rational enumerative invariants. This term is better understood if the dimension of each G of gamma is one. Then you can choose a generator, and essentially A of gamma becomes a rational number. So then in practice, they indeed become a rational number. So this data, stability data on the Lie algebra G, are required to satisfy one axiom, which says essentially that the support of this collection, set of gammas for which A of gamma is non-zero, is separated from the kernel of Z, of the central charge. Kind of informally, this means that if we are interested in enumerative geometry invariants of some stable object, they cannot be killed, the Chern classes or charges or whatever, they cannot be killed by the central charge. And formally, this means that there is a quadratic form, which is positive on the support of this collection and negative on the kernel. So this is a definition, and there are some equivalent reformulations. In particular, instead of collection of A of gamma, you can consider sort of a group elements, take exponents of for each, actually, here there is a missing index I. You can take any cover of the plane by finite union of strict sectors. Strict means do not contain a straight line less than pi. And for each sector, you can consider all gammas with a central charge in this sector. And technically, you should require that Q is positive on these gammas. And take the formal group element considering a sum over these gammas. So this A of VI, is, in fact, you can define them A of V for any strict sector V. And this collection satisfies sort of a more understandable factorization property. If you split a sector into two by taking array, like bisecting into two subsectors, then A of V for the bigger sector is a product of A of V for the smaller one. All right, so generalized DT invariants, they are sort of expressions that do not coincide with A of gamma, but they are certain expressions of A of gamma, which are rather integers. They are defined over Z than over Q. All right, and one more remark about this terminology, that if V is just array, degenerate sector, then the element A of L, this exponent of sum of A of gamma, where Z of gamma belongs to the array, it can be thought as a Stokes automorphism. All right, what else? There is a Hausdorff topology on the set of all stability data on A of gamma, on the set of central charges in this collections A of gamma. This Hausdorff topology is not entirely trivial, but it can be defined, and we did it in that paper of 2008. And the main property of this topology is that the natural projection from stability data to piece of them, just to the central charges, which is a very simple thing, they form a vector space. So this projection is a local homeomorphism. And the wall crossing formulas, which I mentioned previously, and which you saw in the example of exponential integrals, from abstract point of view, they show how the collection A of gamma changes when we move along this topological space and cross the real codimension one wall, subvariety in it. And in terms of central charges, since it's a local homeomorphism, I can say how the wall look locally. It corresponds to those central charges which are not generic, which for which there is a rank two sublattice in this gamma, which is mapped to the straight line. All right. Now, for my today's talk, I will be interested in this very special case of a graded Lie algebra. It's a graded Lie algebra on a torus. So if I have an arbitrary free abelian group, I can construct a torus of character. Torus of characters as, say, complex algebraic variety. So I can look for the Lie algebra of vector fields on it. It certainly has a natural grading, gamma grading. And in this case, there are some interesting special phenomena which do not appear for general stability data. In particular, stability data, these collections A of V, which I mentioned on the previous slide, they can be thought of as a gluing automorphisms of a certain formal scheme. Its the construction is not trivial, but this is the reference to our paper of 2013, where it's kind of discussed in detail, and also we revisited this construction in this archive paper in the last year. But the point is that one can construct certain formal scheme. This formal scheme is a formal neighborhood of a wheel of projective lines, kind of a wheel of CP1s. And we thicken this wheel to its formal neighborhood. And this formal neighborhood is a formal scheme. This is kind of very imprecise description of what's going on. But if you have a formal scheme, you can ask whether it comes from, it's a formal scheme over complex numbers. You can ask whether it comes from the complex analytic space, like from a complex manifold, for example. And if it does, then the wall crossing structure on the Lie algebra of vector fields on the torus is called analytic. So it's sort of an indirect definition of what is an analytic stability data. And analytic stability data is a special case. It's a special case of analytic wall crossing structures. Analytic wall crossing structures are basically families of stability data. Analytic means analytic stability data parametrized by some base. An example is given by the base of, say, Hitchin integrable system or even any Zeiber-Quitten type integrable system, where Z is a period of the symplectic form over relative to homology of the total space of Hitchin system, for example. So then this is a family local system of lattices, which are first homology of the fiber. So they technically, they change from the point of a base to the point of a base, and so change central charges. So then this is an example of a wall crossing structure. Now we can always rescale the central charge as I write here, rescaled by the non-zero complex number. And using this rescaling and using the automorphisms, these gluing automorphisms, we can construct an analytic fiber bundle over C star with the fiber which is isomorphic to the torus, or better to say, to analytification of this algebraic torus. And the construction, again, roughly, we start with a trivial fiber bundle with this fiber and the complement of Stokes rays. And we correct this trivial fiber bundle along the Stokes ray by Stokes automorphisms. In the case of analytic wall crossing structures, this fiber bundle extends analytically all the way to non-punctured complex line. And moreover, it has a canonical trivialization at zero. And we formulated the conjecture in this paper to 2020, last year paper. We formulated the conjecture that having an analytic stability data or analytic wall crossing structure and constructing with it this a holomorphic fiber bundle over C, then any holomorphic section of this fiber bundle has a Taylor series, Taylor expansion at H equal zero, H bar equal zero, which is resurgent. And we illustrated it in several examples, which are non-trivial, in particular, like Ekal theory, Ekal-Voronin theory. Now, in the case of exponential integrals, let's go back. What are these data which define the stability data or wall crossing structure. The lattice is simply z in the power k, where k is a number of critical values. The central charge and the standard sends a standard basis in this free abelian group to the corresponding critical value of the function f, to zi. Now, the wall crossing structure is uniquely defined by the collection of Stokes automorphisms. And so in this particular case, this I just rewritten in the multiplicative form, these wall crossing formulas for the jumps of modified exponential integrals along the thimbles. Or in terms of this data, these automorphisms of the torus are given by this, xi goes to xi up to certain rational factor. And the notation I explained here. Now you see Nij, they of course survive in the definition of the wall crossing structure. And essentially, this is the main object which we need in order to write down this Stokes automorphisms and glue the holomorphic bundle over C star and so on, so on. And this Nij, so we saw them as number of gradient lines of the real part of our Morse function. They, of course, also the number of pseudo holomorphic disks between two holomorphic Lagrangian manifolds. When we cross the Stokes ray. And they can be also interpreted as an intersection indices of two opposite thimbles. We can take two critical points and shoot thimbles from one to another, just towards to each other, and look for the intersection. These are two Lagrangian submanifolds. So they intersect infinitely many points, if, at least if we perturb them a little bit. And so these are integers Nij. And the Taylor expansion of the modified integral along thimble is resurgent. This is a known fact. And it agrees with the general conjecture because the wall crossing structure defined essentially by these Stokes automorphisms, it is analytic. All right. So this is basically a reformulation of the theory of finite dimensional exponential integrals in terms of the wall crossing structures. You can generalize, consider the family, like this is an example. Family depending on the parameter u, say, which belongs, say, to the line, complex line. And this is a family of Morse functions. So then the previous considerations can be generalized immediately. In terms of integrals, we have an integral with a phase which depends on the parameter. In terms of the wall crossing structure, now we have indeed a family of stability data. So it's a non-trivial wall crossing structure, which is defined over the product of u and the punctured line. All right. Basically, you can find all what I told you in that last year paper, 2005. And now I will consider a kind of less trivial upgrade generalization from exponential integrals with single-valued phase to exponential integrals with multi-valued phases. This means that I replace the function, or better, the differential of this function by an arbitrary closed holomorphic one form, alpha. In terms of the geometry of the cotangent bundle, I consider still the zero section as the one of this holomorphic Lagrangian, but the other one is a graph of this closed one form. L0 and L1, they are still holomorphic Lagrangians. For example, kind of, you can consider even one dimensional example can be non-trivial. And actually, I will present two non-trivial examples. One is my X is a C star. The holomorphic one form is this one, 1 over X minus 1. So we can integrate it over a thimble, which is a positive ray. And on C star, there is a natural form, volume form dx over x. Now the symbol is contractible, so the multivalued function becomes single valued on the symbol. So basically we are talking after modifying the exponential integral, we are talking about this type of exponential integral, which can be computed. And up to some factors, again, it's those which appear in the Stirling formula. So it's a gamma function. And so the Taylor expansion of the modified integral, exponential integral, is a resurgent series with respect to H bar. Now we can consider another symbol, which is a negative ray, and do the same story. There is a relation between these two. So we have a similarly modified, so this say right, why it's right, it's better to call left. Anyway, one is right, the other one is, I know, the right is for positive real part of the Planck constant and left is for the negative one, good. And so the wall crossing structure, as I told you, it's equivalent, always equivalent to a certain Riemann-Hilbert problem. And in this case, the Riemann-Hilbert problem is a relation between these two integrals over two thimbles, left and right. And these are the factors. The factors. Again, the story is very much similar to the case of functions, and indeed it becomes such if you go to the universal, say, abelian cover, in this case, it, just to the universal cover of C star, then the corresponding function has an infinitely many critical points. And so there are infinitely many intersection indices, which in general are those generalized Donaldson-Thomas invariants. And in this particular case, in the case of gamma functions, these indices are given by these numbers and AB. AB are arbitrary integers, and they are equal minus one if B is adjacent to A, B equal A minus one. It's equal plus one if B is bigger than A and zero otherwise. Okay, so then this simplest example gives a nice wall crossing structure with infinitely many generalized Donaldson-Thomas invariants. And my last example, no, last example will be on the next slide, and here is some general consideration, which actually, yeah, it's good point indeed to say something more general. All right, so Morse functions, in the case of forms, they correspond to holomorphic one forms with finite set of simple zeros. So in the small neighborhood of each zero, our one form is a differential of the Morse function. And so we can try to define the notion of a symbol in the case of one forms. On the previous slide, in the case of gamma function, I demonstrated indeed that there were two symbols, left and right. But in general, this theory is not known. Maybe it even does not exist. Because if you choose a generic Hermitian metric and convert your one form into the gradient vector field, then the dynamics of the trajectories of this vector field is very complicated, especially when they approach to the set of zeros of your one form. But on the other hand, you can always define local symbols because at each near each zero of your holomorphic one form, you have a Morse critical function and you can shoot a germ of a symbol. So from a mathematical point of view, you can define local Bethe cohomology using these local symbols, but it's not clear whether it's possible to extend them indefinitely to define global symbols, and what is the relation between local Bethe cohomology and global Bethe cohomology. What we can do, we can define global Bethe cohomology of the pair, our manifold X endowed with a holomorphic one form. It's a generalization of the twisted Bethe cohomology in the case of functions. We can define them without referring to symbols. But the question whether the local Bethe cohomology is isomorphic to the global one, it's open question. And it's kind of very familiar question from the point of view of various realizations in terms of motifs. It's example, if such an isomorphism can be established, it's an Bethe local to global isomorphism, which complements to Derham local to global isomorphism, which always exists even in the case of one forms. So what we can do, we can define the local to global Bethe isomorphism in the non-Archimedean framework when we consider cohomology not with complex coefficients or better with coefficients in the local system corresponding to the one form, but with coefficients corresponding to the non-Archimedean rank one local system. Well, so then you see that when we pass from holomorphic functions to holomorphic one forms, we have kind of more complicated mathematics. And this is an example. It's a wall crossing structure for the square tiled surfaces. The general framework, the dimension of my complex manifold, it's still one. Which means that I consider a complex curve, C, say of genus G, with holomorphic one form, alpha. This is a set of zeros. Zeros can have multiplicities. So my charge lattice for the future wall crossing structure will be the relative first homology of C with respect to this finite set. And the central charge is just the integral, it's a period map. So now we can compactify our curve by adding finitely many points. And technically speaking, these points at these points, our form can have singularities, which can be of two different types. They can be first order poles, logarithmic singularities, or higher order poles. So we have meromorphic one form on the compact Riemann surface. And in this framework, one can define the wall crossing structure, but I will illustrate the interesting features of this wall crossing structure, assuming that there are no singularities. I have just a compact curve with one form, which just have finitely many zeros and no singularities at all. I will assume that the periods are integer. So the Riemann surface can be decomposed into squares, or better, it can be glued from finitely many squares by a certain recipe. So this is a repeatable example in the theory of dynamical systems, where people, for example, interested in the number of saddle connections, number of gradient trajectories between two zeros for the flat, degenerate flat metric defined by the one form. And this number of saddle connections, this is of course another example of generalized Donaldson Thomas invariance for the wall crossing structure, which I would like to explain in the case of genus 2 case. Then the Riemann surface can be glued. It's a standard story. I just give you the answer. It can be glued for four congruent squares in a certain way, and this way can be encoded by two permutations for of order four. So then in order to construct the wall crossing structure, we need a lattice. This is the first homology of the curve. Actually, it's not C minus, it's a typo. C with respect to this set. So it's a relative homology, and it's five-dimensional lattice. And the Lie algebra G is just the Lie algebra of the automorphism group of torus. Yeah, this typo. Let's see. Yeah, here the minus is okay. Okay, no, I don't think it's okay. No, it's still a relative homology. So I consider over the character torus of this lattice the vector bundle. Let's see. No, I consider. Yeah, I consider the vector bundle of the character torus with the fiber, which is just first cohomology of this curve, first relative cohomology of this curve with respect to two zeros. In genus 2 case, there are two zeros of holomorphic form. All right, so the torus should be thought of as a moduli space of rank one C star local systems. Or better, as I told you, honestly, one should consider non-Archimedean local system, but let's kind of pretend that everything works over complex numbers. All right, so we have a vector bundle, we have a Lie algebra of the group of automorphisms of this bundle. And let me maybe just show you the picture and then I return. So there are two zeros. And from each zero, I can shoot in any direction a thimble. In fact, if you look carefully, the thimble is formed by two rays in opposite directions. So you should take the difference of them in order to form an element in the relative homology group. It's kind of, it's an infinite real one, an infinite analytic curve, real analytic curve on my surface with possibly very chaotic behavior. And I can do the same thing for another zero. So this is my basis. in the local Baitica homology, but in this particular case, fortunately, local symbols can be extended indefinitely. And so they define the basis in global Baitica homology. So what is left? So I have a lattice, I have the graded Lie algebra. And now what is left is to define these automorphisms AVI, sort of a Stokes automorphism for the sectors, acting on the basis of thimbles, which means that I should take two thimbles, or if you'd like, two values of the argument of the Planck constant. One is very close to the vertical edge of my square. These are red, and the other are relative to the horizontal. So these reds, they form a basis of thimbles in the direction, in the vertical direction. Ideally, I should take just the vertical one, but I cannot do it because it's a Stokes ray. So I take it very close to the vertical. And this is one basis, and another is sort of a horizontal one. And so there should be transformation from the vertical to horizontal, this AVI, for whatever covering which of the plane which I choose. In fact, it's nice in this particular case to choose a covering by eight sectors, but let's consider this picture. It corresponds just to one of these sectors, which is a first quadrant, if you'd like. I take the argument of the Planck constant between 0 and pi/2. So my transformation is a transformation between the vertical and the horizontal basis of thimbles. And so this is what I denoted AV1. Since the basis is two-dimensional, my AV1 or any AVI, it's a 2x2 matrix, which consists entries of which are monomials in elementary holonomies of my local system in the direction of edges. And what is remarkable in this particular case, and probably this is a general phenomenon, that these matrices form of rational functions. Here is an explicit formula, partially result of Maxim's familiarity with computer, special computer programs, which made it possible. So A, B, F, G, they are certain monomials in elementary holonomies of my local system along the edges, horizontal edges and vertical edges, certain monomials, A, B, F, and G. And as you can see, these are rational matrix coefficients. So then the wall crossing structure corresponding this, at least in this example, to a complex manifold endo with a holomorphic one form, it has a rational entries for the connecting or for the Stokes automorphism. So we expect that this is a general phenomenon. All right. Okay. I'll stop here.
Many thanks for your talk. And are there any questions? Maybe questions from the Zoom audience?
Probably everything is clear.
I have a question concerning the conjecture you mentioned from your 2020 paper. Can you tell us a bit more? is this within reach of the current methods? So how long will it take until you prove the conjecture?
Conjecture, I mean about the resurgence. That which conjecture do you mean?
The one you mentioned from the 2020 paper concerning the Taylor expansion.
Okay. Yeah, we think that it's within the reach. We work on it with David Sauzan, who is an expert in Ecal theory. And yeah, we hope that it's within the reach, that the general conjecture within the reach, but maybe we are mistaken. So it's still not proven.
Okay, we'll all be excited to hear more about it soon. Any further questions? No? Doesn't seem to be the case. Then thank you once again, Jan, very much. Okay.